done tier two reports with only five of the hazard categories. Basically, you had your physical and health hazards, which were fire, pressure, reactivity, immediate, delayed, or chronic. Made for a nice, clean, simple report. However, EPA is requiring that starting with the 2017 annual reports, everyone will have to check off all of the hazards that are listed on the SDS. That will be cumbersome for everyone. And as Jules mentioned, that hazard not otherwise classified is the one that worries me the most for all of the facilities. A hazard not otherwise classified, believe it or not, gasoline. And I have a lot of companies that report gasoline. It has a hazard not otherwise classified because it can collect a static charge. So you're going to have to read through your SDSs to see if they say anything like that. I can give you a couple other examples. There are certain solvents that I'm sure you've seen articles where somebody put it on a rag, left the rag in a bucket, and the rag just caught fire, spontaneous combustion. That's going to be an HNOC. So read carefully when you're looking at those SDSs. If it makes a statement that doesn't fall into the regular categories, check off HNOC just to protect yourself. And changes are coming to PATS. For years, if you've been doing tier twos with us, this is where you signed in. We've all grown to love it. I'll say that loosely. We are migrating to a .NET system. This will be what you see when you go to log in. Your usernames will work in the new system. We're migrating all the data, all the usernames. It will all be there. But everybody's going to sign in at the same URL now. Anybody who does a report on ours always knows that you have to go to that /submit website. But everybody will now just sign in at the main one, and it will direct you internally then. As I mentioned, your usernames are going to migrate, as will all of your report data, all of your prior attachments. But the issue is, you're going to have to go in and update every single chemical, because you're going to have to make sure that you change them to the new 24 categories, or you won't be able to do a report. One of the other issues we're going to have is we are discontinuing the MSDS library. For those of you who would select an MSDS from our library, one of the problems we came up with was the vendor that we used for that service migrated over to using URLs where it just pushed you to a link, and under Commonwealth guidelines that doesn't constitute a record because the link could break at some point. So we couldn't continue that process with them anymore. So you're going to have to find your own SDSs in advance. We did send an email out about this in June. Anybody read that email? Thank you. And we're also looking at something different this year, and it's going to stay on the system, so you'll be able to use this for future. We're going to do what's called an update report. So now, in addition to doing your annual, your initial, your revision report, you'll have the opportunity to file what's called an update. Once we go live with this, you can sign into the system, start updating your information, get the SDSs attached if you need to, and file a full update report. No fee. But the benefit to it will be, if you've done this, come January, when we start doing the annual report, you'll be ahead of the curve, and you'll be able to just go in and file your annual based on that update. One of the other things I should point out about that update, we're going to leave that on after the start of the 2017 cycle. But the reason we're leaving it on is we always tell people, if you are doing something where there are changes, changes in personnel, how frequently do you have your contacts, emergency contacts, change? Or your email addresses change? When you start looking at that kind of information changing, you should be going into the system and updating it on your tier two information for the emergency responders to know. If you have that kind of change now, you'll be able to use this update report, and that way it kind of alerts us that, hey, they had some kind of change that didn't require them to do a tier two, but we need to know. This is the screen that you're used to seeing when you first sign in. One of the things we are going to do is replace that one area with an actual 15-minute video, so that anybody who hasn't been able to get this type of information in this kind of environment, they can go there, watch the video, and it will go through the different screens so that they have a visual to follow. The whole system is designed to use more tabs as opposed to trying to figure your way out through the old system. So if you look, you'll be able to go to the home page. You can click on continue, you can click on list facilities from the facilities tab, or the number of facilities at the bottom of the screen to get to your list of facilities that will all be there. You'll also be able to search your facilities this time. And I like this feature because I have some facility submitters that file for as many as 500 facilities. So they can go in and quickly do a synopsis to see certain things. They can even put in information where if they want to know which facilities fall in a particular county, they can do it that way. They can build out their searches. We're trying to make this more user-friendly for our customers, and we're hoping this helps because I know this was an area that people always complained about. Adding new facilities. How many people have ever had to add a new facility in PATS? It was always a little bit difficult to do. We're kind of still following the same process where you have to make the request for a facility ID, give us the basic address. We'll check it, and then we'll just authorize the system to give you an ID number. One of the reasons we do that is we have a lot of companies who change out personnel on a regular basis, and they tell somebody, oh yeah, you gotta file a tier two. So they register on our system, then they go in, and first year we were doing this, we actually had a lot of companies that created whole new facility ID numbers rather than call in and ask. So they could just go in automatically and open a new facility ID number. We have tons of those numbers that are just dead now. We just check it, and if we see that there is an ID, we'll assign it to you. We'll let you know, hey, you already have one. But it'll be the same basic process. You request it. We send you the email with the number. You sign back in and then enter the number in the upper box. Building out the facility record, we have broken down into smaller chunks. I'm sure if you ever had to build out a new record on our system, you typed vigorously trying to get all that data entered within the 20 minutes. We've had a lot of people who called in very upset because they didn't know something and they went off to do something and they got logged out. We're trying to make it so it's smaller, easier pieces to do. So basically, when you're looking at building out a facility, your first part is going to be your facility identification information. We even put in a lot of searchable tabs now. So if you have an address and you don't know what your latitude and longitude is, which was a big problem for some people, now they have GPS, most people can do it easier. But if you have an address, you just click on a button, it will determine the latitude and longitude. And in this case, if you see there, it shows you exactly where it's computing it. There's a dot. You can move with your cursor. If it's over a particular building and you want it shot there, it will actually change it for you. So we like that, because that way if you have 15 buildings on your site with 15 chemical locations, and you do use that feature where you identify by building where the chemicals are, you're going to have the ability to tell us the latitude and longitude for that specific building a lot easier. We also have an NAICS lookup and an SIC lookup. This is probably one of the hardest things for a lot of companies to tell us. Usually when you're the tier two person, you're not the person that necessarily knows what the NAICS code was or is. So you can go in and do a lookup for both of those features. My biggest warning to everybody, if you're putting data into this system, if you see a save button, you save it. Because if you don't hit that button, it's going to go away if you leave that tab. One of the other features we're building in is the ability to import information. We require an awful lot of data. So what we're trying to do is actually help you out a little bit. You can pick your facility contacts. If you report for a lot of different facilities and you just want to import somebody's information that is, you know, is on another tier two, you'll be able to click on that pick facility contact. It will bring up all of your contacts that are under you. It'll look at all your other reports. And you can just pull that person in. Likewise, you can do that for your parent company or your owner-operator information. So it makes it a little bit easier. Of course, if you don't know the information and you want to type it all in where it's not available to you from your contacts, you can actually just type it in and save it. Mailing and billing tab. Again, you want to import information from someplace else, go ahead. If you have it on another report, please do it. Saves you time. Saves us time, because if you knew you did it right the first time, if you don't make an error on the next one, it's a lot better for you, because then you don't have to do a revision. Mailing and billing information is important for us, because those fees that we collect, we're responsible for making sure we get them in. So if we don't see an invoice come in, we are going to end up contacting whoever your billing agent is, which a lot of times now is someone in Idaho, Canada, you name it. But we just need to know where we can go to get the fee part of it paid, because under state law, your tier two isn't considered complete until all the fees are paid. So keep that in the back of your mind sometimes if you don't see that your billing office has handled that. So now you're getting all of your facility information entered. You're going to have to click that save button. Then you can click on Add a New Report. It'll be a button that opens, and what I'm going to tell you right now about this feature. Remember I mentioned the types of reports we have? When our vendor built this out, they only entered that you could do an annual, a revision, or an update report. We need initials, so that tab is going to change. What you're seeing here is actually from our test site right now. But these are the report types that you'll have to select from. If you're going to choose to do that update report, please remember that it is for this year, that you're just trying to update the information. It's still going to require you to do an annual report next year. The other thing is, once you click your report type, then you'll see that you'll get a proceed button that shows up. When you go into your update report, I told you that all of your data is going to come forward. So all the information will be there. But what you will see across the top in this area, right through here, look to that area. If it's got a green for that section, you're okay. You don't have to do anything. If you have an exclamation point, you're going to have to go in and check and see what needs to be updated. And this is basically what we refer to as your home page in the past when you were doing your report. It's going to go down sequentially. The report steps actually follow right along your standard. And basically, when you're looking at it, you're going to review your facility information if you have to make any changes. If not, you can just skip it if it's green. Your chemical list, if you look on this screen, you will see that isValid has an exclamation point on it, which means all those chemicals are not valid. Why? Because you've got to start updating it with your SDS information. So you'd have to go in and edit each of those chemicals. Step three allows you to review your subject to reporting status. As I mentioned earlier, that's not good. You have to review your reporting status. If you're familiar with the tier twos, you know that you have to add if you're a tri-facility now. If you're subject to RMP, anybody here a risk management planning facility? Then you have to put your number in for that too. So you can do all of those features just by clicking the edit button. Then it allows you to review the report contact information, your regulatory. You can review your attachments. We require site plans, but we do give you optional fields that you can put information in. For example, if you are a planning facility and you want to upload your plan to it, some of our counties require it. So you can upload your plan. Then the last step for an update is to submit the report. For annual reports, you're going to have one additional step that'll get slid in, and that is as far as your fee exemption status. We do have certain fee exemptions in the Commonwealth. You can claim one, you check it off and submit it, and then we don't invoice. Now, to update. This will be the hard part for everybody. You'll have to click on the edit button for each of the chemicals. This will be the screen that you'll have to work with. Check off every hazard that applies. If you had an MSDS from our library, it's not going to let you continue because you're going to have to upload an SDS. You already have an SDS uploaded, you're okay, but we have a lot of companies that were reliant on our MSDS library, so you're going to have to make sure you have your SDS available. It has to be a PDF or TIFF, no larger than 5 MB. So please make sure you stay within that range. And again, please remember to click the save button. If you have any questions about what is on that SDS, where you're not sure what it says, or whether you should be checking off that HNOC, contact your vendor now. Get it in writing from them, because they're the ones who know for sure. And I have seen the same substance coming in from different vendors with different information. Sulfuric acid. I've seen different information from different people, different companies. Have the documentation in your file so that if you're ever audited, you can say you went to the company and that was what you were told. I firmly believe in protecting myself. I like to protect my companies. Go to your vendors, ask them what should be checked off. This was an example, and I'm only using this as an example. I have one company that files a lot of reports for lead acid batteries. They went to the supplier. This was the information that they received as far as those lead acid batteries. But it's only by their vendor. But it gives you an idea of how many things you're going to have to check off now, just under the physical and health hazards. It's amazing the difference. After you save that page, the system is going to push you to look at your inventory information, your location storage, for storage, things like that. Just review it. If it's okay, click save. If you have to make changes, make your changes. Now, this is where it always gets tricky on our system. If you've ever added a chemical in PATS, system always asks you, before you can file a report, you have to confirm your site plan, because the system doesn't know if things have changed or what has changed specifically. They just know that you made chemical changes. because you made changes on a chemical page, you're going to have to confirm your site plan. So don't be surprised when you see that. Just, if it's okay, if the site plan's good, just click the word confirm and you'll be good. Not sure of something, you can cancel the report. So you still have the option at this point of either canceling it or clicking the submit report button. Again, on our old system, and still on the new system, that last step is that you have to certify the report. That is a state requirement. So you're gonna have that checkoff button. It says that you're certifying the record. And you're gonna have to click submit. That certification process is important because I don't know how many of you are aware of this, but my staff, myself, we can't go in and change a single report. We are under orders that when you certify that report, that's your signature on it. If we change that data for any reason, it compromises the validity of every report on the system. So we never make a change to your records. Then I just wanted to point out as well that you do have the follow-up screen that will come after you submit the report. You still have to print off one copy for your fire department, send it to them. Make sure you do that. Make sure you print off your certification page for us. And if you have somebody that you've got to send that report to, you can always save it as a PDF and email it to them too. I have a lot of companies now that are sending their reports by email to the fire departments. Anybody here ever do that? Makes it a heck of a lot easier for you. Saves postage. You can even send a read receipt so you've got the information then. This is your current chemical page. This is what you see when you print a tier 2 right now. That's what it's going to look like in the future. Same chemical. Because of those 24 categories, your reports are going to be much longer when they're printed. So be prepared for that. It gets very busy. You can also come back in and review your submission status. How many of you ever check back to see when we have reviewed it and approved it? Traditionally, my office is reviewing in our, quote, downtime, when we don't have the TRI reports coming in or checks coming in or tier 2 fees coming in. So it's usually the fall when we're doing most of those reviews. So if you don't get your report in early and you come in with the, I think we received about 13,000 annuals last year. If you come in that end of the cycle, we're gonna get to them very late. But you can always come back here and check to see what the status is on your report. And you can also retrieve your submission docs. If you wanna go back in later and get them, you can always come back, pull information that you need. The other thing we did wanna point out to all of you is that the middle of the view report, you can actually get into all of your documents. If for some reason you need something, you can come back in and pull it anytime you want. And this is the end of your view report. The view report is not the same as your printed tier 2. It will show it the way it looks on your home page. So be prepared for that difference. The My Account tab is something you didn't have before. What this does is it gives you some information on there where you can reset your password inside the system if you want. How many have ever gotten yourselves locked out because you couldn't remember your password? Yeah. I've done it too, quite frankly. When we test, we have to test is every user ID, every user type. And sometimes I forget which one is which, so I'm guilty as charged too. But you can reset your password there. You can also edit your user account profile. And I wanted to get into this a little bit as a warning. Your user account is specific to you. If you're filing on our system, it means that you are the one who is doing the report. Never pass that information off to another party. If it is given to somebody else to do that as their job task, please don't give your username and your password to that next person, because you take the credit or the blame for all the work that was done with that particular user ID. If you don't think that's important, I can point out one individual in Western PA who had the unfortunate situation where his company was audited by EPA, and EPA asked us for reports, and I had the name of the reporting agent. Turned out that he had not filed the report, someone else had done it on his behalf and made a major error. The company was fined, I believe it was $51,000. And he had to take the blame for it because his name was on there, even though technically somebody else had done it. Don't pass your name off to somebody else. If your boss tells you, hey, we want so-and-so to do it, fine. Have them register on the system. We'll delete your user ID, disable it when we enable the new one. It's just a bad practice to get into. One of the things I will also point out, EPA's new fine structure starting this year. Anyone know what they can charge per chemical if you miss it? When I started doing this in 2001, it was $25,000. It is now $54,789 per chemical per instance. And if EPA chooses, that instance can be as little as a day. And they can start adding it up. They normally don't, but they have that allowance. So I would not want to be the one whose name is on a report that I didn't do. One of the other features on the system is you can kind of query it and do all kinds of neat things with it. If your query is too large and it's going to tax the system, it will tell you that they'll do it as an offline report. You can come back in later in the day and pull the report. You got a billing tab, so you can go right into your billing information if you got a question. You can check and manage your invoices to see what was going on. You can also view your account summary at any time. This is my reminder about the site plans. We require certain information on your site plan. Facility ID number, facility name, address, latitude and longitude. Directional north, street orientation, and some kind of identification as to where the chemicals are. If those aren't on there, you're going to be marked as non-compliant. You're going to get an email from my staff or myself asking you to file a revision report with a corrected map. And you can do these really easily. All you have to do is pull that picture from Google Maps if you want and put it on a Word doc, type the other information in, save it as a PDF, and it's done. I've shown people how to do this. They've been so frightened of it, and it is very easy to actually do a site plan for us.